Hey, good morning to all of you. It's 11 a.m. IST. Welcome, a very warm welcome to all of you for taking this time out and for being part of this very important webinar discussing the role of women in digital transformation. We'll give maybe a minute more for others to join us. Hardik, can we have the slides, please? All right. So the topic, as I mentioned earlier, is the role of women in digital transformation. It is a very important topic because when you look at research reports worldwide, we are seeing a big disparity between the gender divide, as it is called. It's more visible when it comes to digital in specific, which is seen as the domain for men. Very few women in technology leadership roles. They say the KPMG report says only 5% of technology leadership roles are occupied by women, right? So that's the state of affairs right now, which has far-reaching impact, at a society level, organization level, and so on. That's essentially what we are going to be focusing on today. If we can move on to the next slide, Hardik. Yeah, so I'd like to quickly introduce you to Nolscape. Some of you obviously know about us. Just wanted to set the right context there for the session here. And then I'll pass this on to one of our women leaders, Ramya Lakshmanan, who is the Director for Customer Success at Nolscape. She'll be presenting the three-piece approach to promoting women in digital. And it's an incredible honor and pleasure to introduce you to Mr. Ashok Pamadi. I'll do a formal introduction later. He's a CEO of NASSCOM Foundation. He'll be presenting his insights to us, and then we'll open this up for a Q&A. So that's going to be the agenda for today's session. So quickly about Nolscape, we are all about experiential learning for the digital age. For the last few years, we've been helping organizations across many countries, in fact, deal with the digital age and the gap that exists in talent today. We've been helping the acceleration of talent transformation using experiential learning and simulation-led products. We've been in the corporate learning space since 2012, 100 plus happy employees, 320 plus facilitators across many countries. And we are a winner of Brandon Hall Awards, Deloitte Fast 50, and so on. And we are present in four countries, headquartered in Singapore. We have presence in India, US, and Malaysia. So essentially, our expertise in this space, both in digital as well as women leadership, comes from our experience working with large multinationals and a lot of regional leading organizations, right? 300 plus organizations across many countries. We do work with partners across 20 plus countries, and we touch close to 100,000 learners in a year, right? That sort of gives us a good vantage point to look at the issues with talent, with capability, and specifically in this case, what is happening with women leaders inside organizations. So in a nutshell, what we do at Nolscape is we focus on leadership, and for us, leaders exist across all levels within the organization, and leading now and leading next are the two solution areas we focus on. Leading now is all about preparing leaders for today, and leading next is all about future skills. That's where we talk a lot about digital transformation. And quickly, what's unique about methodology is the use of simulations as a way of helping people unlearn, relearn, and acceleration of learning is also done through this very interesting format where the learner is immersed in a virtual context in a real life like situation. It's a safe environment to make mistakes, learn, test your hypothesis, and so on, right? Over the last few years, we've developed a host of simulations that cover 100 plus leadership competencies. And more, we are focusing on leading next, which is digital transformation. So one thing that is unique also is the ability to not just create a great experience, but also map that with talent, intelligence, and analytics. Every product that I showed you earlier generates a report that gives you red, amber, green on multiple competencies. So setting the context now, if you go on to the next slide, Hardik. Yeah, so I had the chance to publish this book last year called Clearing the Digital Blur, published by Wiley. And this gave me a good idea on what's happening in the digital world, right? Although I didn't look at this topic from the involvement of women in digital transformation, it did give me certain insights that I can share with you in the next few slides. So essentially, BLUR is an acronym that characterizes the world we live in right now, where things are becoming boundaryless. If you think about what's happening in ecosystems around you, look at Amazon, Google, any of these tech giants, they are operating in a boundaryless fashion, both outside the organization and inside, right? So the silos are getting busted. Second is limitless digitization, where the boundary between the physical, digital, and the biological, that's blurring away. And unbounded innovation is industry boundaries blurring away. So each one of these dimensions is about a line that is no longer that important. Used to be important in the industrial age, but now these lines are starting to matter less and less. Unbounded innovation, as I mentioned, is about the industry line blurring away. Think about how digital native organizations are transcending all kinds of industry boundaries. And today, the threat for disruption comes typically not from the incumbent in the same industry. It comes from somebody from outside the industry. And relentless iteration is about the time dimension blurring away, the now, new, and the next. Right? So that's essentially what that is about. So when you look at this lens, look at the world around you through the lens of digital blur, you will come up with a lot of insights. If you take banking, if you take healthcare, if you take pharmaceuticals, retail, every single organization that you can think of, those lines are blurring away. And what this does is when lines blur away, what happens? We get disoriented, right? We're not able to hold on to anything. That is what is causing disruption at scale. Now, the key question is, what are some skills that we need to be focusing on, right? And more specifically from a women readiness perspective, right? If we can move on to the next slide. Before I do that, I want to bust the myth that digital is all about technology. Of course, technology is a big part of what the story is, but there is a whole new range of human skills that are important, right? And I'm bringing this up because there's a classical notion, a stereotype or a bias that the involvement of a role of women in technology is limited, but digital itself is not completely about digital. It has multiple other things where be it a technology role or something on the human side, there is a role that everybody can play. So I just wanted to broaden that horizon to give you a glimpse of what are the skills that we need to be focusing on. Moving on to the next slide. So if you take a boundaryless organization, this calls for the ability to network, right? The ability to network within the organization and outside the organization. And here, what is very important is relational intelligence, right? And this, I think we are playing on a level field from a gender perspective. So relational intelligence is very important for building boundaryless organizations. Limitless digitization, while it's about data and analytics and some hard skills, the human side of that is also about storytelling with data, right? And so that's a level playing field at the moment. And unbounded innovation is all about design thinking, right? Ability to think like a designer, where empathy is very important to understand human issues. And then finally, rapid iteration or relentless iteration is about the agile methodology. It's a methodology that anybody can make use of, right? So these are some, human skills that we can develop to basically do well in the digital age. And when you speak about leadership competencies, if you think about a boundaryless organization, network leader, right? So the ability to apply relational intelligence. Limitless digitization is a sense-making leader, the ability to look at data and say, hey, this is what's going on. And unbounded innovation is relentless application of design thinking and becoming a design leader. And relentless iteration is about applying the agile methodology, not just from a project standpoint, but also from a strategic lens. So if you look at various research reports, now that I've focused on the what of skills, right? What should we be learning? And they're pretty much it's a level playing field. When you look at various research reports on gender divide, you see poor participation when it comes to STEM mainly. Right now we are adding arts also into the mix and making it STEAM. But fundamentally, starting from primary education to secondary education, the knowledge and skills that need to be imparted to girl children and then women, growing women, and then of course in the workplace, there needs to be a lot of focus on science, technology, engineering, and math. You see worldwide, there are a lot of initiatives that are happening today. Lack of role models, I spoke about this, only 5% participation of women in senior leadership roles when it comes to technology industry. And there are a lot of biases, right? Keeping this whole digital thing aside, in general, there are biases, societal, organizational. Today, AI algorithms are also building in biases. So that is an impediment. And when you look at digital entrepreneurship opportunities, far less funding opportunities for women entrepreneurs compared to male entrepreneurs, right? So that needs to be bridged as well, which is a funding scenario. So that's not an exhaustive list, but these are the top items that often come up in research reports. So that's a quick context setting that I wanted to do before passing this on to Ramya. So at this point in time, I'd like to invite Ramya Lakshmanan from our team at Knowlescape. Ramya, over to you.
Thank you, Rajiv. Good morning, everyone, and a warm welcome to this webinar one more time. And Hardik, would you give me access to share? You guys are able to see my screen?
Yes, Ramya.
Oh, all right. Okay, so thanks, Rajiv. Thanks for the introduction and setting the context up front. So just taking a minute to introduce myself. I am Ramya. I head the global operations and delivery for Knowlescape. It's great to be here, to be co-hosting this webinar with Rajiv and Mr. Ashok. And it's even more exciting for me because it's one of my personal favorite topics on women, which is the role of women in technology and in digital transformation that we are going to see today. So in the next 10 minutes, we will focus on only two things. The first thing broadly is around giving you a perspective of what organizations can do to enable women right from the entry level inside an organization all the way up to the executive level to reduce the gap that Rajiv spoke about. And the second thing that I would spend time on is Knowlescape's work when it comes to diversity and inclusion programs when we work with our customers. So this is broadly what we'll be spending time on in the next 10 minutes. Okay, so moving on. Okay, so this is a perspective that I want to start off with, right? So there is this 3P approach where we think about the first P around the people. So how can organizations make D&I an organizational priority? By this, what it really means is, can we come up with organizational metrics and track their performances to ensure that we actually grow and improve year on year? Because this is a long-term game, so we start now, right? So that's something that we want to start off putting people at the center, especially women in this case, right? And the second P that I want to start, nudge you about is in terms of processes, because it is not going to be an overnight change for all of us. It's going to be a journey. So how do we create processes that are long, that has long-term vision and fundamentally change a few things at a systemic level so that it sustains over a period of time and we reap the benefits, right? So what are some changes that we could do at the process level? And finally, the product, which is the actual business itself, how do you create your solutions, your product design, which is very inclusive in nature, right? After all, you're designing solutions for 50% of the market, right? Which is going to be anyways used by women. How do you ensure you include women when you create such solutions? So this is a 3P approach that we want to give you a perspective to think about. And before I show up the next slide, what we are pretty good at Knowlescape is engaging folks. While engaging, you also learn. So we want to have a quiz of sorts in the next 5-6 minutes. So if you are, be ready, be get access to your keyboards, and I'm going to open the first question for the day. So this is the question: what percentage of unpaid work is done by women globally? While we know it's higher than men, but what percentage are we talking about? Would like to hear your answers on the screen chat window, please. Give me a second. I'm just figuring out where the chat window is. Yeah, so so we've got many answers, 60%, 75%, 97%. Right, so pretty close, and some of you actually got the answer right. So we are talking about 75% of the work done globally, which is unpaid, right? So interestingly, in the book that I read recently, what it says is there is no such thing as women who doesn't work. It's only women who doesn't get paid enough or doesn't get paid at all, right? So that's a whopping 75%. What it translates to is approximately 40 hours additional work that women do on a weekly basis, right? So what does it really mean for the organization? So we'll attack the first P here. So making an organizational priority, right? So what we are talking about is what organizations can do, right? In terms of building an ecosystem to support women, right? To sustain this journey. Some policies are already in place, right? So all of these policies are not very new to us, but what we need to pay attention to is how many of these policies are really being effective. How many of them are helping you to make that cut, right? So that is something that organizations may have to make a priority to measure, right? So that is the first P. Second question for you guys. What percentage of women drop out from technology, specifically because we're talking about digital transformation here, after the first 10 years? But what I'm very, very keen to understand is the rationale behind the reason, the dropouts, right? So why do you think this happens? Can I request answers on the chat window, please? 30 to 40%, 70%, 45%, family priorities, childcare responsibilities, absolutely, 80% family priorities, 50% because of time, glass ceiling, family and childcare. Okay. So thank you for the answers out there, right? So that's what I was also thinking when I actually read this report. But the answer is 40%, but that's not surprising, right? What was surprising is actually why, the rationale behind why women drop out. It is not because of familial reasons. It is not because they have lack of enthusiasm for the work that they do. The research report actually talks about three things primarily because of which women drop out. One is the workplace scenario, the safety and security policies, work from home policies, flexi time policies, work and life integration, right? So all these policies, for example. So the workplace condition was the top reason, followed by the support from the manager, support from their peers, right? And finally, giving them a career roadmap, giving them a career progression, right? In the long term, also was a reason, primary reason for why women actually drop out after the first 10 years. So the 40% was not more surprising to, at least personally for me, the reasons were, right? So that's something that we need to pay attention to because this is fixable, right? So P for process, what are we talking about? How do you create long-term processes that can sustain over a period of time? Here, the key word is nurture. So don't leave it to nature. How do you nurture over a long period of time so that you have more women on your leadership roles? Some things that the World Economic Forum cites is around how, in your employee life cycle, there are many such touch points, right? How do you ensure there is inclusion in every such touch point? Talent sourcing, which means, does your job advertisement, is it biased, right? So in terms of you're using an algorithm, if you're using a tool to hire people, is that tool gender bias free, right? So a few things that you can do proactively. And when we talk about processes, we are not focusing just on women, right? So women leadership, women should develop, all of that is okay. But what can the men in the organization do? Are they having any subconscious bias? How do you make the male leaders aware of such biases? How do they have crucial conversations with women? How do they push them further, right? It's not just about women, but it is also about the male colleagues that women get to work with. So how do you develop both of them in parallel? Because working on one will not help. Right, so that's the second P on the process. Third question to you guys. Last year, this technology giant EX and famous investment bank Y were investigated for discriminating against women for falsely determining their credit limits to make a payment or a transaction. Now identify X and Y. I'm going to see my answers. Okay, the answers are yet to come up, I guess. Any answers? Any guesses? X is Facebook. Okay. Yeah, so this name is quite popular. Just giving another couple of seconds before. Any clue in the source? This was published on The Verge last year. Yeah, yep. Google, Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs is partially the right answer. So the answer is Apple Cards. Apple is the company, X, and Y is Goldman Sachs. Interestingly, right? So the reason, even if their credit scores are the same between men and women, women's credit limit was 20x, 10 to 20x lesser. And this was actually tweeted by Steve Wozniak, who was the co-founder of Apple, right? Interestingly, on Twitter. So this is on further investigating what really happened. It was just the algorithm that was playing its cards, because they gently thought women will not be employed, and hence they will not have as many spending power. So that was the rationale behind the credit limit difference. But so that's the bias introduced in technology because of the biases that we as coders hold, right? So that's an interesting answer there. And the last question for the day. The proportion of women taxi drivers increased to 14% in the US because of this company's digital solution. Which is this company? This is actually a giveaway. US and taxi, Uber. Yeah, so that's the answer. So let's talk about one side of things where the gender-biased algorithm and technology, the devastating impact that it can have versus the positive impact that it can actually have. So the digital tools, if used appropriately, has created opportunities for 6% of the population in the US for women to be financially independent, to be able to increase their spending power. And on the other side, for the business, right, they've opened a new market segment whose revenue is actually coming from these women drivers, right? It's a win-win for both the community and for the company doing this business as well. So that's the other positive side of what happens when you include women in your decision-making process, in your solutioning process, right? So that's what I want you to think about in terms of building products, building services and solutions. How do you include women in your design and solutions, right? So two key things that I'd like to touch upon is design thinking helps you to be inclusive irrespective of, basically for everybody that you are designing the solution for. But what I want you to pay a little more attention is on the data part, because most of these are technology driven, which is, digital solutions are primarily technology driven, and it holds a lot of bias, like Rajiv said, right? The AI bias that we have. So how do we collect sex disaggregated data so that you know what percentage of your data is coming from women users and men users, and you can design and improve solutions that will cater both. So not assuming the male defaults, right? And second, how can you be more conscious about the algorithms that you create when you write test cases or whatever, right? So how do you ensure that it is taken care of is the other thing that I thought it's interesting to pay attention to. So that's the end of three P's that we have: product, process, and people. And what are some things that organizations can do in the short term to the long term to reap the benefits? So we've covered the first point in the agenda. Now we've come to the second point in the agenda. So what is Nolscape's role in the D&I programs, right? So some case studies for you, some programs where I've personally worked with our customers in these initiatives, right? So the first initiative that I want to talk about, which is very interesting, is one of the largest IT services firm had this as their goal. This is the D&I right at the center, right? Organizational priority that we spoke about. They want women to take more of P&L roles, which means they want more women to perform better in their sales and consulting roles. So this program was aimed on how do we develop financial acumen, their business acumen, their ability to build trust with customers, long-term relationships with customers. How do they deal with organizational politics? How do they deal with managing complex stakeholders? So all of this is quintessential for their role in sales and consulting roles. So that's one part where we were involved. And the second one is on the is a company that we worked with, which is a leading company in the shipping and logistics area, and primarily focusing on what can women do better in terms of how can they be more confident in their communication, how can they be assertive, how can they have that presence when they are in a leadership position, how is their ability to build networks, and the most important of all is the ability to actually negotiate, right? Negotiate for that raise, negotiate for that opportunity, negotiate to get your idea to the table, right? So these were some things that we partnered with for this particular customer. So the other thing that I want to spend a couple more minutes is the first part, people, is something that I spoke in the last slide, which is focusing on developing women, right? The other part that we also focus is on how do the male colleagues, male peers, or even female peers and female colleagues help women grow in their roles, right? This is the support system, the ecosystem that we spoke about, and their capability, right? So we also work with male leaders to ensure they overcome their personal biases, unconscious biases, holding those crucial conversations, having a target to help women grow in their teams as well, right? So that is some deep work that we do. And apart from that, we also help with coaching and mentorship opportunities for women in these organizations. And the last part where we spoke about technology and inclusion in the technology, we help people in the design thinking methodologies in terms of how can you be more inclusive when you create a solution for your organization. And again, when it comes to businesses, how can you think differently? The BLUR framework that Rajiv spoke about, how can you actually deploy them to widen your business revenues, right? By addressing both the multiple segments in the market. Lastly, what I want to leave you with is these two women personally inspires me a lot. While there are many other women out there, these books actually personally had a lot of effect on me. So Sheryl Sandberg, and most recently Invisible Women by Caroline, she focuses primarily on how data bias is actually influencing a lot of decisions, which could be detrimental, right? So that's something very interesting for you to read over the weekend. And finally, making a business case for gender diversity, right? This is a case study where Best Buy actually formed Women Leadership Forum inside the organization because 89%, that is a whopping $68 billion of revenue, actually come from women users, right? Women customers. So how can you be more inclusive in your business, right? The last one thing that I want to leave you with is in terms of the business that you're doing is actually addressing 50% of your market. And if you're not including women, then you're actually misjudging 50% of the business that you do. So thank you for this opportunity. With that thought, I will pass the baton back to Rajiv to take over. Thanks, everyone.
Yeah. Thank you, Ramya, for that really insightful presentation. Without much further ado, now I want to invite Mr. Ashok to present. So just a little bit of introduction for Mr. Ashok. 30 years in sales and marketing of IT products and services and for nonprofit organizations. So he's had a stellar career. And now at NASSCOM, over the period of last 5 years, he has scaled SME vertical to newer heights, and he has made it a very strong value-adding component to the organization. And he has transformed many non-performing assets into performing trends for IT BPM industry ecosystem, and has initiated disruptive initiatives to strengthen NASSCOM's skilling and reskilling goals, right? And he's very passionate about diversity and inclusion, and I'll invite him to make his presentation now. Welcome, Mr. Ashok.
Thank you, Rajiv, and good morning to all of you. It's indeed a pleasure to be amongst all of you in a topic which is very close to my heart. I've been leading diversity and inclusion for the last 7 years at NASSCOM, and all the activities what we do, I would say 80% of our work today in the NASSCOM Foundation is under the gender lens. Having said that, it's a very, very interesting phase we are in, and thanks to pandemic, the disruption is happening like never before, and we are clearly seeing some winners and certain laggards who are still lagging behind as far as being very inclusive in their business, and obviously the overall business is getting impacted because of that fact. What I would like to share with you is I clearly see, Ramya, it's a fantastic thought process what you have, and some of them actually I'm endorsing what she had presented to you. But I would like to spend a little more time on understanding what exactly is why the role of women becomes very important in digital disruption, and what's in store for all of us in the years to come. So this will be the overall theme which I thought I would like to share with you. And they have given me controls on the screen. So I would like to present this particular slides to you. I guess all of you are in a position to see my slides. So what is the role of women in digital transformation? As you're all aware that as on date, we have about 48% of the population in India are women, 1.3 billion population, which is growing, you know, at a pretty fast rate. Our population, you know, is definitely growing at around 1.6 to 1.7 per annum. While certain states have slightly more women and many states have less women. And this one area which comes in a very important aspect for all of us is that diversity is built into our DNA. Because every 200 kilometers you travel in a country, you'll find different cultures and different languages being spoken. So in that aspects, we are very fortunate that, you know, the diversity is built in our entire DNA system. But having said that,
if I may point out, then the slides are not visible at the moment.
Okay, thank you. I thought it's visible. Okay, thanks. Okay, just a minute. I will just try to share it once again. Is it visible now?
Yes, it is.
Thank you. So we have, as I said, it's 48%. And but having said that, what is very alarming is a fact that just around 22% of the labor force are currently women. And I'm talking about the entire population. I'm just not looking at the tech industry per se. And it's alarming because from 90s, where we were at 30%, we have come down to 22%. And our neighboring countries, for example, Nepal has 80% of the women working. Bangladesh, Sri Lanka too have higher figures than us. So obviously we have as a nation much more to do to ensure that we are getting women into the workforce, and more so now because we are talking about a digital nation. We are talking about a 5 trillion economy, and obviously it's very, very important for us to ensure that we pave the way and make our entire organizations and our cultures to ensure that it's inclusive is built into our DNA. Now, if you look at any decision making today, especially in urban areas and many tier two cities, women play a very important role as a consumer in maybe buying a house or maybe taking some loans from a bank, or it could be education, or it could be healthcare, or it could even be aspects of buying any other goods for the family. It's the women which is the center stage. And if you look at any of the ads today, it's clearly very heavily women focused because they are the key decision makers in many of the crucial decisions which the family is to take. So women actually belong in all places where decisions are being made. And that's a very important element for all of us to understand that they are playing a very crucial role. But having said that, when you look at the smartphone users today, they have almost reached about 700 million, but women are less than 50% of them are actually having mobile phones with them. And if it comes to rural areas, it's even less. So obviously we have a lot more to do to ensure that financial inclusion as well as digital inclusion are actually being taught to the women so that we are empowering them to take crucial decisions. When you're talking about a $5 trillion economy, obviously, what comes to our mind is the tech industry, the IT BPM. And I call it tech industry because today IT BPM is just not narrow to only IT services and business process management, because it actually encompasses other areas as well. For example, R&D and, you know, startups and product companies and so on and so forth. We clearly see that we might reach around 435 billion by the year 2025. This is as per McKinsey's report. Now, in this industry, it's a classic case where it's actually proving to the world that as an inclusive, industry, we are able to get better creativity, better innovation, and obviously better profitability to the organizations. We have currently 35% of women in the tech industry. this nowhere else. In fact, we are actually having the highest number compared to even US and Europe. No other country is having so many women in the tech industries what we are having. Clearly demonstrating that. And what does it demonstrate? It demonstrates that 55% of the outsourcing market in the world is actually coming from India. Clearly showing that an inclusive enterprise obviously are able to lead the business in all fronts. That's one aspect. But having said that, there are very other industries where we believe the role of women is going to be very, very important. One of them obviously is financial services. Now, if you look at financial services, it's literally, you know, anytime, anywhere banking. And today it's a really borderless, you know, nation. And I would say the world is flatter than ever before. In having said that, when you look at it, there is definitely a disparity between, you know, the urban and the rural in India, number one. Number two, there's a big gap in terms of digital literacy, or what we call it as digital divide. And here we have to play a very, very active role in ensuring financial inclusion and obviously a little bit of technology are actually being, you know, taught to women and empower them, because you are going to give the decision to them. And what happens is, and immediately once you do that, it's clearly seen that in the pandemic, the unicorns which came about were actually the ones which are actually in through payment gateways. For example, Razorpay is now an unicorn, and it happened because of pandemic. And obviously, women play a very crucial role. Now, this particular thing also basically I call it as upstream businesses and downstream businesses are actually enhanced by getting more women, you know, in the digital transformation. Now, digital transformation, as Rajiv pointed out, is just not technology, it's various other aspects too. And that's where an important element where we can all of us play in the financial inclusion. Same with retail. If you look at it, retail today, e-commerce. While we clearly see in the pandemic, the e-commerce, you know, they were the highest recruiter in the pandemic, the Amazon, the Flipkart, the Swiggy's and Zomato, but it's still, as of 2 years ago, as per McKinsey report, we are still at 5%, whereas Indonesia, almost around China and Indonesia are around 15% is the e-commerce and e-retail business. Now, there's this particular business where women play a very crucial role, because you look at any of the e-commerce business or any of the e-retail, you clearly see that backend is actually, we require a lot of women because they understand the psyche of the buyer, which are largely women, number one. Number two, if you look at the entire logistics supply chain management, we do require a lot of women across the length and breadth of the country, and we require digitally trained women folks available in plenty in the country. I would like to take this here. Healthcare is a classic example where actually empowerment of women actually villages, and this is Anganwadi workers. Anganwadi workers are actually being apps by means of it. They are able to, things have been taken by them, and they are able to ensure that they are also able to ensure those the small infants are being, you know, given the right time, the inoculation, or the pregnant women are being basically able to give the right vaccination at the right time. We also believe that while it's lowest in this six data where it's so digital, when you're talking about a digital nation reaching 5 trillion, health is about 10 billion likely to reach around 2025. But what is very interesting is, this is one of the largest, I would say, a recruiter of women. You know, you see all the healthcare workers, we have a lot of women. And we believe health tech will be highly disruptive as we go forward, because we have, in a country, you know, the number of what I call it as primary healthcare centers are very less. People have to travel to 2 to 3 kilometers to reach a primary healthcare centers in the country. That's one. Second is, we don't have enough doctors nor nurses currently. So telemedicine and various use of technology, health tech technologies, will make a difference to a country. And this is actually going to be led by women, because currently, as I speak, there are more women in the healthcare industry, and you just have to ensure that they are digitally enabled. And because of that, we are going to bridge the gap in the healthcare shortage what we are having in the country. Same applies to areas like labor markets, jobs and skills. For example, the number of teachers, and is currently what I call it as a hybrid education, is going to be the order of the day. No more you're going to have typically classroom led, even in small towns and villages, because every village anyway is going to be connected through fiber. You're going to see that hybrid model is going to come. That will be the order of the day. And obviously, digital, it's the way the e-government or the e-activity is happening. And here I would like to share my own personal experience, and this happened on Sunday. It so happened that I have to basically ensure that the e-mudra, that is basically the GST, I have been the CEO of the firm, so I had to get it done because it was expiring on 14th December. So I filled it up on a Sunday, being a holiday. But believe it or not, I never expected a call center calling me on a Sunday and assisting me because I filled the wrong number, and they said, sir, you have filled up wrong and that's why you're not able to complete. Now that's bringing in transparency. That's use of technology to the highest level possible, because I personally experienced it this Sunday. And I make it a point to talk about it because I was pleasantly surprised, and I got it done with the help of the call center who called me. And please understand, this is government office, right? And they called me on a Sunday and I was able to complete it, and I've got my code and other things what is required as far as GST is concerned. This is amazing piece of work what the government is doing, and I'm sure there'll be many more such things which will happen. What is bringing in transparency? It is also helping women folks, because there are a lot of schemes which they are doing currently, and only thing is what it's required is to ensure that a women are digitally empowered. Example, a widow pension scheme. Example, an LPG subsidy. Or for example, the farmers. Directly it's going to them. So what is required is more and more women to be digitally trained is the answer for the country. Having said that, Ramya mentioned about the three P's, and here I would like to talk about one P, which is the people. We believe that people are at the center, where our entire focus is people, and obviously it's going to be women in a country where we have only 22% of the population working in the labor force. And using data and technology as the key drivers. Now, data and technology is going to be very, very important, because they are the ones where the people are going to get empowered. And by using enough data, accurate and trustworthy data, we are going to make a difference to the women of the country. And technology obviously is going to play a role. We talk about big data, we talk about artificial intelligence, we talk about cloud computing, and all the different technologies are going to come to fore. And we are going to leverage to make more and more people, and obviously women too, empowered as we go forward. And people are going to be the heart of digital transformation. Having said that, this is a very interesting chart, which I picked it up from the labor ILO. And what it shows is the workforce participation in Indian women versus US women, and Indian men versus Indian women. What it clearly sees is, see in this, there's something like a U curve, which is depicted here. And you find that, lot of not literate people are currently working. The reason is very simple, that in a country about 72% of the agricultural women folks in rural areas are actually women who are working currently. Okay, that's the data. Second thing, you find that in tertiary education, they are all working. Tertiary means they are degree holders. Example is our IT industry. IT industries, all of them are graduates, and we have 35%. And there are many such industries where we have a lot of women working. But we have a large chunk of them, they are literate up to primary and middle and secondary and higher education. They're not working. They are girls 15 years and above who are not working. Believe it or not, at one shot, if we get all these women back to workforce, India will increase by $440 billion. Dollars, it can be increased by the workforce alone if we get these women to work and work in a digital fashion. That's one. And if you look at McKinsey's report on the gender parity, they clearly mention that we reach a gender parity where both men and women work across the globe. There'll be about $12 trillion added to the economy. In India itself, $770 billion can be added to the economy. This is reiterating one and the same, but we have gone finally granular and found out where the challenge lies. And the challenge lies in, anyway, we can't do much on literacy because we still have about 22% of our population who don't know how to read and write. But digital literacy is something different, right? We can even train those people who don't know how to read and write on digital literacy. Okay, that's one aspect. But here is a very interesting thing that we have a large portion of them who are actually not working. And that's something which all of us can collectively do to make a difference to the digital nation. That's one. Second aspect is, today we have a young nation. If you look at our own digital, if you look at our tech industry, our average is only 27 years. And we have nearly 35% of our entire population who are actually in the working class, right? So as a nation, we are young. So many of these youngsters today, we call them as digital native kids, right? And all these women too are young. So they can be digitally trained. They can even be taught coding. You don't have to necessarily ensure that all of them have to be engineers. As Rajiv mentioned, it's not necessary. We are already talking about STEM to STEAM, number one. Number two, technology is becoming so very ubiquitous that you actually don't require coding to operate actually many other technologies like AI. You require different, skills to manage to use technologies, and those skills can be actually be taught to various people across the country. Now, here is some, interesting data for you. Typically, any human being has what is known as a left brain and a right brain. Some data prove, they say that, women have more right brain than left. But having said that, it's all of us have some left brain and right brain, okay? But it's predominantly noticed that in the tech industry, both men and women actually are the ones where they have more left brain. That is, they are the ones who have digital skills, digital native type of people. They are good in, data analytics. But looking at the world of disruption, we do require people with emotional intelligence. We require people with a lot of creativity. We require design thinking, as what they mentioned, and we require adaptability. So these are some things which we require a population which have both left brain and right brain. And obviously we do require both men and women to ensure that we remove all biases. Otherwise, data is already proving that they have only men, basically working in AI. You will get, unconscious bias or conscious bias, you are getting different data points. Whereas you have, both the people working together, and obviously you'll get a end results with no biases. So it's very important to ensure that we have enough women and more women in the workforce. So tech industry, as I said, has really pointed out to a direction. And I would say the last 3 years, phenomenal changes have happened. When I started off, it was hardly 20% in the tech industry. Today, it's at 35%, okay? And we are clearly seeing that there's been a 2x increase in the percentage of women at the executive levels. And here are some of them. I know you have international crowd out here, but we have, the president of the largest tech industry, Devjani Ghosh, is there. Then we have Rekha Menon from Accenture. Then I was fortunate that I have one, she's my boss now. And I was also fortunate that I worked with Neelam for about 7 years in the past. And they are actually clearly proving that when women are there at the helm of these industries, they're not only actually disrupting their enterprises, they're disrupting their clients. And obviously, when a client and various other enterprises get disrupted, obviously the nation too gets disrupted. That's why we call ourselves and say, we are a digital nation. We want to be a 5 trillion economy, because disruption has to be at every level, at every stage, on every walk of our life, disruption has to enter into our thing. Again, what Kiran has mentioned, as a women leader, my message to all women is that India's economic future will largely depend on gender inclusion, and women have to play a very important role in shaping our economic future. And some of the international crowd, Kiran Majumdar Shah is the founder and chairman of Biocon, which is a leading pharmaceutical company in India and one of the forerunners for the COVID-19 vaccine. And she is, I would say, an ardent supporter of the tech industry, although it's a related industry, but she's always been supporting the tech industry in a very big way. So I would like to leave behind a last quote, that is, any society that fails to harness the energy and creativity of women is at a huge disadvantage in the modern world. So thank you very much. Over to you, Rajiv. And thank you once again for having invited me home.
Thank you so much, Mr. Ashok. That was very, very insightful and really well presented as well. So I know we are running short of time here because of the delayed start, but I want to make sure that we have the opportunity to ask you questions. Can you highlight a few things that NASSCOM Foundation has done, right? Specific initiatives that you have undertaken over the last few years and the outcomes that you've been able to achieve.
Thanks, Rajiv. Basically, I would like to answer it in two ways. One is NASSCOM Foundation, the other one is the NASSCOM Diversity and Inclusion. Although that particular initiative is actually currently being managed by the foundation, but D&I is a very separate, very, very focused initiative which started about 10 to 12 years ago at NASSCOM. So we realized that, you know, the number of women leaders are less in the tech industry, okay? Because when we have 35% is not good, we got to move more. And we got to just not look at that number. We have to look at how many are in the C-suite, how many are the executive level, manager level, and so on. So keeping the entire digital disruption in view, we have started a program called Women Wizards Rule Tech. And the entire objective and endeavor of this program is to nurture women and all the other elements like mentoring, Gurukul, hands-on experience, right? All those elements have been covered. It's an industry-led program because the mentors are from the industries. The guru are nothing but subject matter experts. They are from the industry. The lab experience too, the industry is providing. And NASSCOM Foundation is basically executing as a program managing this entire activity. And this is already running through 2 years. The success we have seen is there are many women, you know, this is more of an awareness program. They have further gone ahead and learned more. And there have been some women who have actually had transformational changes in the roles what I'm doing. So that's one thing. Purely from the foundation, we believe that as a foundation, we got to play a big role in ensuring that more and more women are actually being trained on digital literacy, okay, financial inclusion, as well as the future technologies. So we play a big role keeping the gender lens in view, and we work on in slums and rural areas on digital literacy with a focus on women so that we empower them on financial inclusion as well as on health and hygiene. It's also an equally important role is what we do currently. And we play a role as a direct implementation partner, as well as an aggregator, because there are many other NGOs who are working in this direction. So we also help them in this endeavor to ensure that we make our country as a digital nation as we go forward.
Great, wonderful. Thank you so much for that. I request all of you to post your questions on the chat window. There's one more question from my end. If you had a magic wand, Mr. Ashok, to remove some of the obstacles in the ecosystem, how would you use that magic wand?
Magic wand, I'll ensure that first, I think I already mentioned, I would like all those women who are sitting at home 15 years and above, like one wand, I want all of them back. Our income goes up straight. Our GDP will go up like by 440 billion. That's the one wand which
wonderful. Wonderful, awesome. There's a question from Maushmi. Yeah, can we discuss possible digital transformation opportunities in the insurance or financial services industry?
It's a good point, a very good question, because this is one of the good fast growing areas in the financial as well as in insurance industry. So one of the areas which we're clearly seeing is, you know, we talk about anytime, anywhere, banking, et cetera, right? Now, if you think about it, while this is great, but there's something on the financial inclusion at the grassroots level. And I think that we got to play more because our neighboring country like Bangladesh, you know, you must have heard of Grameen Bank. It's a classic example of how they are giving empowerment to women, since its entire focus is on women. So I brought this particular subject. And I think that is a very important area. While there are many such players today in the microfinancing, but we don't have so many, like, or at least the success what our neighboring country, Bangladesh, with thanks to Grameen Bank has got, right, Mohammed Yunus. We have not done that yet. Number one, we have not reached the scale as what is required in a country like ours. I think that is the answer for it. And obviously, government of India has done that, you know, Jan Dhan and other things, the number of people went up like anything. But still, we have to ensure that more and more women are actually getting, you know, financial inclusion is there. Because the data doesn't show that all the women are actually getting the benefit, number one. Number two, they are still not financial inclusion is still not there with them. So there's a lot of work still to be done.
All right. So in the interest of time, maybe we'll take one more question. This is from Sangeeta. How do you onboard more leaders to actively participate in D&I initiatives on the ground so that the few who actually come forward are not fatigued?
See, actually, from our side, this is purely, I'm answering it from the NASSCOM perspective side. Okay, so our focus is on technology. So we require more technologies. Okay, and one thing is that more leaders have to be nurtured. You know, the leaders don't come automatic, right? So this is great initiatives done by many companies like what they call as return to work program, because, you know, women take a break, right? And we are clearly seeing that leaking pipeline is there in the industry because we attract a lot of women in the entry level. After some 8 years, they quit. So they're all sitting at home. So one is to get them back because they join at the middle level. You know, once you give them sufficient training, they can join at the middle. So you're able to nurture them. That's one good initiative which companies are doing, but we require to do more. That's one. Second is, we require, as you rightly said, that fatigue and other things. I don't think a leader should get fatigued till they retire, actually, and there's no retirement now. But having said that, what is very important is that we require more leaders because they are iconic leaders. They are role models. And women always look at another woman as a role model. So I would say, Sangeeta, to your question, more the merrier and more are welcome. So you just have to say, yes, I'm ready. Because generally, what we have seen is that actually we have to go and nudge them. Please come and speak. You know, that's the challenge we have with many, many women. They don't come. You know, so I would say, Sangeeta, I'm happy that you're coming forward. We want actually more women tech leaders in the industry.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you all for participating and great questions. You can, of course, reach out to us on social media platforms and continue the conversation. You can feel free to connect with Mr. Ashok as well. He's been doing some phenomenal work at NASSCOM Foundation. It's quite inspiring to see the kind of progress we've been making, but it's a long road ahead as well. So I think collectively, when we work together, I think this is a mission that can be accomplished. Thank you so much, Mr. Ashok, and thank you all of you for taking this time out to be part of this very important discussion.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Rajiv, and thank you.
Team. All right. Thank you, everybody. Bye.